And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 3. What we're going to be doing now is a quest, which is not labeled on the galaxy map, but I saw the Shrike Abyssal there, and so I know where this is, or where this, the nebula is. A Volus diplomat needs a Prothean obelisk. Recover it from the Shrike Abyssal and deliver it to him at the Citadel Embassy. Now this also, I'm going to note, Benning. I missed the evidence on the planet when I did the N7 Cerberus whatever. Sucks. Cerberus abductions are down here. So I missed something. Evidence of his son, unfortunately. I try to be thorough, but I felt like I was just going over the same places, the same locations over and over again. Off screen I try to go back there. We cannot land on the planet. So hopefully I can recover this some other way, or we can land on a planet at some other point, or get the evidence some other way. It's still in my quest log, which means it hasn't failed. So it's here, and you know, hopefully eventually you'll see me accomplish this. Anyway. For now, Shrike Abyssal. I'd play it over. Excuse the throat noises, but that would be cheesy. We're coming from the PAX system, which we randomly ran to escape Reapers. I forget where they were. Oh, I came from Kite's Nest, right. Recovering Batarian artifacts. We're missing one. I believe. And one here as well. So after we complete a mission, we can go back to these two and try to find those. Oops, sorry about that, guys. I'm trying to move my mouse in a small area known as a mouse pad. All right. Zecha system. I remember exploring, I heard that.
Something.
I was right on it. Awesome. Wreckage. 150 units of fuel. Unfortunately, we're already full, right? We've recovered 50% of assets. Alright, let's start looking at planets and stuff. Zadaban. It's very familiar. I think we landed on Zadaban, possibly. Zadaban is a large, dense planet named for a Volus god of punishment. Its crust is rich in uranium, eroded by winds to create large radioactive dust storms across its surface. The Volus of Talisphia have explored the planet thoroughly with space probes and telepresent robo-mining machines, and discovered that they are not the first to exploit the planet. Plastics from a mining station approximately 50,000 years old can be found near the planet's equator. Curiously, the mines nearby were not tapped out of uranium ore. They were instead abandoned at the height of their operation. Colony founded in 2154. Population is 22,500 in orbital stations, and capital is none, but the largest station is Dolo Station. Dolo. They only live once. That's what it stands for. Afras. Zathras? Not the one. A unique discovery, Afras is a heavenly twin, a planet in a star system that has not one, but two worlds of sufficient mass to retain a nitrogen-oxygen atmosphere within the habitable life zone of its parent star. Fossil evidence shows... Fossil evidence shows abundant vertebrates and evidence of a sapient terrestrial avian species in its Bronze Age. However, the only trace of contemporary life on the planet is that of single-celled organisms in its seas. All else has suffered from an extinction event, a series of massive impacts that vaporized vast quantities of water and lofted dust into its atmosphere. Early theories that this event was a collision with a fragmenting asteroid have now been discounted. The impact craters were aimed directly at habitation centers. Well, damn, don't wipe out the cool bird race. Wait, we already kind of have a bird race, don't we? Is that a ban? Tosalnim. The sister tragedy to the extinction event on Afras, Tosalnim was the rarest of jewels, a second garden planet within the same life zone as Afras. Not as old as its sister planet, its fossil evidence indicates it was home to abundant invertebrate sea life. However, similar craters to those on Afras created a dust shroud that killed 99% of biota on the planet. The even spacing of the craters indicates a coordinated simultaneous attack from points around the globe, rather than an asteroid collision or supervolcanic scenario. Bad juju, man. Bad juju. Vem Aska. A Jovian gas giant, Vem Aska, weeping witness in Hipparion Volus, is a low-density hydrogen-helium planet with 35 moons. Later this year, 33 of the moons will be visible from the planet's surface in a conjunction, an event that will be recorded by space probes from all over the galaxy. Interesting. I'd say less probing conjunctions and more stopping Reapers. Alright, so we can run that way. Yeah, they're not coming from that way. We'll try to hit these two planets. We got something here. Hold on, Reapers. God, it's so... I gotta move the mouse so far. Probe away. Dispatch 10 probes. Oh, cool. Lost and found. Achievement. We got credits. Wish they said how much. ~100%. Yay! Continuing. Do we... Wait. We're at 100% for... But just in case we have to come back here... Yeah, there's no fuel. Damn it. There is no fuel. Let's go to Kizil and see if we can go to Early Rast and then back. Nasgrowl. Nasgrowl is a small, hot, tidally locked inner planet that had modest minerals development on its dark side. Within a generation of the Vorcha's first contact with spacefaring species, robo-mining interests attempted to exploit it, only to find their trading partners violently overthrown on a regular basis. The Vorcha's own culture disenfranchised them in Nasgrowl's case, as their legal claims to the planet were inevitably backed up by violence as a show of dominance. This nuance was lost on the mining corporations, who hired mercenaries to guard their operations with lethal force and never surrendered it to Vorcha claimants. The Reapers sent a small force to destroy Nasgrowl's orbital station and surface facilities. There is no indication that there are any survivors. Sad. Heshtak. A Systems Alliance official once summarized his tour of the Vorcha homeworld as follows. You can make your own Heshtak in two steps. Take Hell, then add Vorcha. The planet is highly volcanically active, leading to periodic releases of toxic gas into the air and water supplies, as well as other extreme situations that gave rise to the Vorcha's legendary adaptability. Overcrowding and the extermination of most of their ecology led to a planet covered in weeds and hardy vermin. The Vorcha do not have a recognized single government that would allow them membership in any galactic league. Alliances between bloodlines are tenuous at best, and the Vorcha's short, violent lives ensure there are few lasting institutions. The Reaper invasion of Heshtok encountered little formal military resistance, but the harvesting process is slow. Destroying neighboring cities fails to intimidate Vorcha, who becomes submissive only if physically dominated in person. Cutting off their water supply simply makes them adapt their bodies to get moisture from food. Allied intelligence hypothesizes that Reaper forces are not harvesting yet, instead seeking to immobilize Heshtok's population and prevent them from joining the fight for the galaxy at large. Population. Lack of census data spreads estimates from 6.0 to 9.3 billion pre-invasion. Capital is Hattash, which is disputed. Next planet. Parask. A lifeless desert, Parask was colonized soon after first contact with the Vorcha. Several Asari mining corporations, starting with a CRE-based charity called Mind and Hand. Asari CRE. Well, you're really just mixing up the letters, aren't you? Built settlements on the planet's surface and orbital stations. Adopting Vorcha orphans from Heshtok, they raised them to live non-violent lives and employed them in the mining industry. While Mind and Hand's efforts were at first labeled colonialist, the orphans became minor celebrities when it was discovered that the Vorcha habit of using violence to communicate was not completely innate. Several spoke throughout Citadel space on behalf of their species, but their short lifespans kept their careers very brief. Even today, companies that want Vorcha labor have a poor choice between adopting and educating them as youngsters just to watch them age and die, or dealing with autonomous but violent adults. The Reaper invasion devastated Parask. Its industrial capacity was ruthlessly targeted, and the Vorcha mining communities were exterminated. The only silver lining is that the deaths here have created martyrs, inspiring other alien-raised Vorcha to fight for their galaxy. Well, that's good at least, I guess. Lirat. The hydrogen-helium gas giant Lirat was the site of a brief and decisive battle between Vorcha and Reaper forces. It was impolitically characterized on the news vids as millennia-old death machines versus a gang of teenagers, a reference to the Vorcha's brief lifespans and inexperience. In reality, many of the ships were commanded by other species to avoid this shortcoming, but the insult still sticks. The defenders outnumbered the Reapers, but their force was comprised of light ships suitable to a militia, since never before had it been in anyone's best interest to allow Vorcha to build a dreadnought. Superior Reaper firepower soon wiped out the Vorcha fleet, and the fuel infrastructure around Lirat was pulverized. Rumors abound that the Reapers did not lose a single ship. I don't know, they're not losing a single ship anywhere though, right? Last planet, another gas giant. Vostaka. This methane ammonia gas giant was swept past during the Reaper invasion, and once its helium-3 collection equipment was destroyed, it was largely ignored. Vorcha ships that survived the attacks on Heshtok and Lirat can be found discharging their drive cores here before making spy sorties or retreating further into space. Alright. Wait.
Signal confirmed.
I heard it. 350 units of fuel. Cool. So back up to... We don't see fuel, do we? 50% of assets recovered. Go here and check these planets. Aha! Wait, Reapers. Probe away. Void Devil's Fighter Wing. Cool. Whatever the hell these things are, we're finding them. 100% recovered. Yay! We're going next, Earl Arrast. I have 1,000 fuel again. Well, let's see if we can find more fuel in Earl Arrast, and then we'll be okay to go to the next one. If I stop going past it, that'd be great. Bovis Tor. Or Bovis Tor. Named the Shining Sea in an old Volus language, Bovis Tor is so named for its boiling surface rich in glowing hot alumina, flecked with dark ridges of carbon. Its thick atmosphere of nitrogen and oxygen is no indicator of life, since the temperatures are simply too high. Stuff. Talisphia is a planet capable of supporting life, if that life happens to breathe ammonia. Discovered by Asari explorers, the planet was used as a bargaining chip by the Citadel Council, who quickly drafted a colonization agreement with its wealthy client race, the Volus. The Council would fund the Volus colonization effort in return for massive trade benefits. With uncharacteristic enthusiasm, an enormous Volus influx ensued, and the Council reaped the economic benefits for a dozen years before the colonization bubble burst. The Reapers found Talisphia easy prey. The independent planet had a defense fleet only sufficient to handle small-scale actions. Its high population and industrial base, once a deterrent to war with other Terminus system worlds, has only served to attract a large number of Reapers, or a larger number of Reapers than usual. Colony founded in 385 CE, population is 3.8 billion, which is pre-invasion, and capital is Usra Dao. Alright, so I looked here, right? Bovis Tor, Talisphia, and Daz Atab. An ice giant, Daz Atab, Sky Warden, has a bluish tinge from its hydrogen-methane atmosphere. Its axial tilt causes its seasons to vary wildly in temperature. Alright, see if we can get these two planets in the middle here.
I found something.
Found something. You haven't recovered yet. I was looking at the percentage, but we have to actually find it first. I missed the little radio signals, though. Homing in and hearing the audio change. Probe away. Prothean Obelisk. That's what we were looking to find. Cool. There's another artifact, though. I start listening for the sound. Just trying to home in on this one. Wait, I heard it. units of fuel. Done. Get the hell out of here!
Faster than light jump successful.
Cool, back to 1,000, so we can go back to Thal. We are doing well. Let's check out these planets. Xercio. A hydrogen helium gas giant, Xercio's many moons were developed along with the colonization of Altakiril. It is believed that the majority of them were military in nature, a common theme among Turian colonies. Specifics are few. Altakiril's government kept its records classified, and the Reapers have systematically destroyed the installations here. Those bastards. Let's check around the asteroid belt. Or this one, anyway. Ooh. Found a little T-Rex here. T-Rex, one of the largest objects in Thal's asteroid belt, is a metallic asteroid with a iron-nickel core under a rocky olivine mantle. It is possibly a remnant protoplanet prevented from forming into anything bigger by gravitational disturbances from Xerceo. Interesting. Anything else? Alright, let's check out Alta Kirill, mentioned already. Alta Kirill is a garden world on the outer edge of its star's habitable zone. The planet is largely frozen, yet it features native dextroamino acid-based life in its lower latitudes. These species evolve to withstand periodic freezing and compensate for the cold with spectacular population explosions, during the long, mild summers. Hardy, independent-minded Turians colonized the planet. The Quarians briefly considered contesting them, but were daunted by the virulence of the planet's infectious life during the growing season, not to mention the colonists who had ties to warlords elsewhere in the Shrike Abyssal. Alta Kirill's citizens were wiped out by Reaper's bombardment, despite the planet having a reasonably high population, which would usually make it a candidate for harvesting. Allied intelligence suggests that the colonists kept anti-space defense weaponry in population centers, so the Reapers limited their risk by destroying the threat and moving on. Colony founded in 2021 CE. Hey, that's in like 5 years, guys. And the population is 13.5 million. Pre-invasion, of course. Capital is Estivus Irax. Serrate. A large terrestrial Serrate's methane-rich atmosphere might be mistaken for that of a true hothouse planet. However, some terraforming corporations have targeted for development since Serrate has already given rise to some cyanobacteria in the liquid water that can be found near its poles. There is some evidence that the planet has been fluctuating between methane-heavy and oxygen-heavy atmospheres for several million years, each cycle dependent on the nutrients in the ocean that led to bacterial growth or crashes. Star charts catalog several scientific stations studying Serrate, but all appear to have been destroyed by the Reapers. And finally, Garan. Garan is the innermost planet of the Thal system, which is less than 2.56 million kilometers from its K-class parent star. Temperatures on the sunward side of this tidally locked planet reach more than 2800 Celsius, boiling away earth and stone. These gases are then carried away by wind from the hottest point to the zone where temperatures are cool enough for the gaseous mixture to recondense, leading to the unusual weather phenomenon of rains of rocks. Great, can you imagine being in the middle of that? Garan remains largely unexploited by commercial interests, as the heat of the star tends to ward off all but well-funded collection ships like the so-called Inferno class that mine Ezo near energetic stars. Garan does not appear to have Ezo, and its other elements are not worth the setup cost. Alright, stuff. There's no reaction here by the Reapers, which might mean there's nothing here to be found. What is this?
Signal confirmed.
Oh, we got something here. Vorcha labor team, nice. 50% though. By the gas giant? Oh. something here, maybe some fuel. Yep, 400 units, cool. And we're 100% with everything, done. Alright, need to go back to the mass relay. Are there Reapers in here? No, thank God. We'll go back again to Horsehead Nebula. And fuel up. Hell yeah! Cool. Just check for emails and stuff. Nope. Just recovering things lately. Done. We do have to do the Leviathan thing. Eden Prime. Tuchanka we're gonna hit all together when we want to continue with the main quest. Tuchanka again. Ooh, Ismar Frontier, cool. Have to figure out how to do that, maybe. Irune. Huh. Avolus. We were just in that area, weren't we? I guess Irune is not in the Shrike Abyssal. Yeah, I don't remember coming across an Irune. So maybe somewhere else. Either way, we'll find it. Barlavan, yeah, again, the Krogan DMZ. Tuchanka, we'll head there with the main quest. This, I don't know. We'll have to find it in our travels. This we found. This we have to find in our travels. That when we go back to the Citadel. And on the Citadel. So it looks like we're either doing Eden Prime or Leviathan next. Or maybe Ismar Frontier really quick. Okay, thanks for watching, guys. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.